Hello everyone. Today, we will take a closer look at the image generation algorithm used in the Digital Garden project. Additionally, we will create an average tree by crossbreeding various other trees. We will also delve into the animation mechanism that I've implemented. To begin, I'll explain the core concept of the project before delving into each specific gene. Genes are represented as a table, which in turn determines a tree's appearance. Rows in the table represent parameters, while columns represent levels. The drawing process is executed by agents, each tasked with drawing circles. These are known as first-level agents. From the first column of the gene table, agents retrieve information about circle size, color, whether attributes should change at each step, step count, offspring count, and directions. An agent draws a circle and moves according to the specified direction. If the gene calls for changes in direction, size, or color, the agent adapts, draws another circle, and continues. After a set number of steps, the agent produces up to 3 second-level agents, determining their directions before termination. These offspring agents inherit the size and color of their parent. Second-level agents gather data from the second column of the gene table and combine it with inherited data to proceed with their drawing process. Upon completing their designated steps, they may generate third-level agents, continuing the process. However, agents at the 10th level do not create offspring. Now, let's explore our circle drawing technique. While basic circles would suffice, this approach might lack visual appeal. To address this, we've devised a creative workaround. We begin by drawing a white, semi-transparent circle offset to the left and upward. Then, we draw a black, semi-transparent circle offset to the right and downward. Finally, we draw the circle with the desired color atop these two circles, creating the illusion of three-dimensional space. Now we'll provide an in-depth overview of the virtual tree's genetic makeup. The first gene determines segment length. Larger values prompt agents to draw more circles within a segment. The second gene controls circle size, affecting segment width. Another gene dictates how circle size changes with each step, creating the conical shape in segments. We introduce 3 additional genes, each specifying the red, green, and blue color parameters of the segment. For smoother color transitions, let's introduce 3 more genes to define the changes in respective color parameters. After an agent completes its work, it terminates and may leave up to 3 offspring. The number of new agents is determined by a specialized gene. A gene governing segment branching angles is also present. New agent parameters are influenced by their parent agent and the corresponding gene table column. The final result is as follows. Each segment's width is independent, yielding a less consistent appearance. To address this, we introduce another gene to make segment width dependent on the preceding segment's width. This gene finds a middle ground between the circle size from the gene table and the parent agent's size. This new size is used for drawing the first circle. If we set this gene to its maximum at each level, new agents will use their parent size. Now, let's conduct a small experiment. Adjusting the gene responsible for segment width results in thinner segments with each iteration, right down to negative values. Negative width values do not impact drawing, as negative and positive radius circles appear the same. Next, I'll add another gene to control segment width. While not strictly necessary, I believe it improves results. Each level has predefined circle size values. With hard-coded and calculated sizes available, we use a gene to find a middle ground. With this gene's value adjusted, each level's circle size matches the hard-coded value. Now let's focus on color genes. Right now we have genes dictating color through values and parent agent color. We introduce a new gene that will determine the segment's affinity towards the parent's color or gene color. setting this gene's value to its maximum for all levels except the first results in each segment starting with its parent's color. Let's create a diversity gene. Higher values lead to greater color deviation from the initial value. You can evaluate the effect. At this point, each segment is a straight line. To add visual interest, let's introduce another gene. As this gene's value deviates more from the average, the agent's movement offset increases. Maxing out this gene causes tree branches to bend inward while minimizing leads to outward bends. Another gene determines the magnitude of random changes in direction that an agent can make. For now, we'll increase this gene's value only for first-level agents, resulting in slightly curved lines. Then, we'll adjust this gene for all levels. Let's reset this gene. The plant looks too right. Another gene controlling a random length addition to a segment introduces more variance among same-level agents. Next, I'll add one more gene. This gene influences the initial direction of the segment, similar to the length gene. The result is a much more natural-looking tree. Modifying the first segment's color affects the entire tree due to the parent's color usage gene being set too high. Independence of 10-level segments from parent parameters and shaping them as cones lead to improvement. However, more enhancement is possible. Introducing yet another gene. The lower its value, the more the segment leans upwards. Higher values lead to downward-leaning segments. Creating a first-level segment with three branches expands the tree crown. Additionally, we'll make second-level segments lean upwards and add more randomness to 10-level segment directions. Finally, some color adjustments will complete the result. Our genes are just table values, which allows us to merge tables how we want. My approach is straightforward. In the resulting table, I modify a single random cell to introduce a new mutation. Now, we'll crossbreed this new tree with another. The outcome is always unique, sometimes showcasing unusual mutations. What if we combine dozens of visually appealing trees to determine the average tree? Each gene value averages across all trees. Let's give it a shot. Lower levels tend to be darker, while upper levels contain more green. Personally, I expected there would be more gray shades, as I like unusual colors. The average tree appears plain, highlighting the subjectivity of attractiveness. You might have encountered articles online about average human faces. You can also find images of the average human faces in different regions. Few label these average faces as unattractive. Even if non-conventionally attractive faces are used, the average face appears pretty okay. This suggests that the closer your face is to the average, the more people might find it attractive. However, the situation differs for ornamental plants. An average plant often looks ordinary, while unusual shapes and colors are considered more appealing. Thus, each object category adheres to its own beauty standards. I think so. Animating the trees was an afterthought, primarily for the video. As animation wasn't the project's primary focus, it had limitations. First, use trees with an equal number of branches at the first few levels. Otherwise, the animation may look ugly. Second, the first levels should have no curved lines, as this can negatively affect the smoothness of the animation. Everything else is fairly straightforward. Well, almost. We have primary frames with predetermined parameters. In intermediate frames, we gradually adjust parameters from the first main frame until they match the second main frame, and so on. The project's source code is available to Patreon subscribers. I extend gratitude to everyone who watched, liked, subscribed, and shared my work. Until next time.